says you need a vacation for a view like this. Or, I wish there was a place to get in shape. Try getting on the beaten path. Discover an ever-expanding network of trails and greenways. Some quintessential southern beauty. Or romp through the woods in a magical land between the rivers. There's more to explore than you ever imagined. Beyond the swing sets, Breck, we are more than a playground.
Hi, business owners. Phase 3. Woohoo! But do your customers know you're back? Well, that's where the Clarence Bug Show and Pelican Broadcasting can help. Right now, we've got great rates on advertising packages to help you get the word out. Shoot me an email at bugsclarence@gmail.com. Or better yet, call me up. I'd love to talk with you. 225-485-6839. Let's get together and make Phase 3 the best it can possibly be.
Hello, guys. It's Debbie. It's time. I've got a brand new location. 10510 Airline Highway, Baton Rouge, next to After Five Tuxedos. We have the perfect spot to get all your wedding and formal wear needs. Come see our one-of-a-kind name brand and get great prices. With 30 years experience, the best customer service anywhere. It's Debbie's Bridal, Airline Highway, Baton Rouge. See you soon.
Getting a letter from the IRS that you owe back taxes can be scary, but it doesn't have to be. Call Go Tax Resolution in Lafayette at 337-420-1040 today. We'll help stop garnishments, levies, and seizures immediately. With over 35 years of dealing directly with the IRS, our team of local professionals will help you pay the least amount possible. So if you owe back taxes to the IRS, you need help. Call the tax professionals at Go Tax Resolution in Lafayette at 337-420-1040. Your go-to tax relief.
Welcome to today's edition of the Roger Cato Show, week number 18. Coach, good to have you back, young man.
It's good to be back.
Let's start with bowl season. Arguably the most anticipated out of the slew of bowl games was Alabama matching up against Cincinnati. As most of us thought, Alabama dominating. No big surprise there.
No big surprise. And they went right at them and ran the ball, I think, 9 of the first 10 plays and scored a touchdown. And pretty much it was over with. Now, granted, Cincinnati didn't play bad after that. They played relatively well. Right. They just couldn't do much against a really superior Alabama team.
The big argument among a lot of the so-called experts is whether or not Cincinnati, quote, deserved to be there because of their record. Did they?
Yes, they deserved to be there. It didn't matter whoever it was, Notre Dame, Oklahoma, Baylor, whoever the other team were, the same thing was going to happen. What happened to Cincinnati, they were going to get beat by Alabama.
Yeah. Michigan dropping like a big rock in a tub of water with Georgia. Again, no big surprise, or like me, you thought Michigan would make a better game of it.
I never thought they would. Let me just say this. You're talking about heavy leg kids from the Midwest in the cold weather playing against really dominant athletes from the South.
Right.
And it showed they couldn't even compete with the speed. Uh-huh. And then the physicality with those athletes on the line just took over.
You look at the outcome of the SEC participants in the bowl games, not impressive to say the least. Is the SEC still head and shoulders above everybody else, or is it more a case now of Alabama and Georgia are head and shoulders above everybody else?
No, they still are where they are. Remember, a lot of those kids opt out the bowl game.
Right.
Because they didn't want to take a chance getting hurt. So the bowl game meant nothing to the other SEC schools. You know, it meant something to a Tennessee, which they were trying to win. Mm-hmm. It probably would have meant something to a Mississippi, Ole Miss, and those kind of teams, because get their records up and get ready for next year's play.
So, championship final, Alabama, Georgia. Who do you like?
Why are you asking?
Inquiring minds want to know.
All right. Listen, Alabama has obviously got an edge, but Georgia really does have a good team.
Oh, yeah.
I keep saying it.
Oh, yeah.
And it's hard to beat a team twice in 1 year.
Uh-huh.
Basically, in literally one month.
Right.
So you really got to, you know, give Nick Saban the edge. But Vegas is saying Georgia. They're giving Georgia a point and a half, I think. Or 2.5 points, I think. Vegas. Those are the people who are supposed to know.
Right.
I don't know.
But they also made Alabama the underdog.
Yes, that's what I'm saying.
I mean, that it's still inconceivable to me that you would, as a professional, put Alabama as the underdog?
Because they look at Georgia as a great team.
No. With Cincinnati, they went in as a, quote, underdog.
No, I don't think that, huh?
Nah.
Alabama was underdog against it. No way.
It boggles the mind.
Yes, if they did that, it's no way.
Now, you mentioned how tough it is to beat a team twice in the same year. Is Nick Saban the exception to that rule?
In a normal year, he is.
Uh-huh.
When things are normal, everything is normal, he is the exception. But we're talking about 2022. We're in a year that nobody knows what to expect.
Good point.
We just starting out, Clarence.
Yeah.
We'll be only 10 days into the new year.
Yeah.
Anything could happen.
You look at the transfer portal, the opt-out options. Has all of this reduced the relevancy of bowl games? Or is that just something that comes with the territory?
Well, things change.
Uh-huh.
As we go along in life, things change. Listen,
right.
The bowl games were getting to be what they are. You know, they found a way. The NCAA found a way to make, I think, four of them still relevant.
Right.
The Sugar Bowl is still relevant.
Uh-huh.
The Cotton Bowl, Orange Bowl, and the granddaddy of them all in Pasadena, California.
Right.
They found a way, and then we didn't mention the Fiesta Bowl. But what they did, they made the playoff a part of the Bowl Alliance.
Right.
Except now they're going to play the championship in Indianapolis,
uh-huh.
which I don't like that. I thought they could have gone to Dallas and played in Jerry's Bowl, a big AT&T park.
Right.
I thought that's where they maybe should have gone.
Uh-huh.
You know, you would have been keeping the thing pretty close. You could have gone to Atlanta again, but Georgia probably wouldn't want to go there.
Nah, too many bad memories.
Well, they would have been close to each other.
Yeah. When you look at the relevancy of the four that you mentioned, five total, expanding the playoff format to eight teams, will that diminish the remaining bowl games even more?
Well, it's going to always mean something to the teams that can go participate.
Right.
Listen, why? They have the extra practice days.
Uh-huh.
That's why it's going to be important. Coaches sort of like that.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? They can have extra practice days. And the schools do realize some dollars
mm-hmm.
from bowl games. You got
mm-hmm.
me? So the big schools will still benefit. The medium to less pack in the medium pack of the schools, it's just something for them to experience.
Ultimately, are there too many bowl games, Coach?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
But if the dollars are there, Clarence, we live in America.
Yeah.
You know, corporations spend money. They have the money. They spend it. It's an experience for the kids
mm-hmm.
and their fans. You
uh-huh.
got me?
Uh-huh. From a recruiting standpoint, how much weight do you think that carries? How many bowl appearances you've had in recent memory? Does it still pack the same kind of that it did at one point?
Those kids now, the majority of the kids, they're all thinking, I'm going pro. And all they can think, what program is going to help me get there?
Uh-huh.
And that's what they're thinking.
Yeah.
You know, so kids don't know. You can go a lot of places and still go pro. But there are some schools, like in Alabama, you're going to work hard to get there.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
You know, and some of the kids have complained that Nick Saban works them way too hard. Their body never get a chance to relax and get back. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
Soon they finish the season. They're in the weight room. They're training for next year.
Yeah. But you're also looking to make it a, quote, profession. So that should be expected of you either way. How is it Nick Saban manages to get a certain caliber athlete? I watched an interview over the weekend, and they were interviewing the Crimson Tide in the hotel, and I forget the young man's name, but the reporter asked him, well, what have y'all been doing to have fun? He said, well, we've been watching film, we've been critiquing, breaking stuff down. The reporter said, no, in your leisure time, what do you do while you're here to have fun? This guy looked at the reporter and didn't bat an eye, Coach. He said, preparing to win is fun. And I knew right then, this guy's going places.
Yeah.
He thinks, well, he's of the opinion, preparing to win, that's as much fun as you can have. How does he manage to get that caliber athlete? And is that sentiment more prevalent than what we think it is?
I can't say it's more prevalent. I think that the environment that Nick Saban has created over there, that's what it prepares.
Right.
It permeates that. Let me tell you something Nick Saban have done also. Because the majority of his kids are African-American players.
Right.
Nick Saban went into the city of Tuscaloosa and talked to the barbers.
Wow.
And he looked at it and he said, I'm going to build y'all a place in that area where they have all of the stuff for football.
Nice.
He said, so y'all could, I'm going to pay y'all, put all new equipment, do it, y'all be able to cut my players' hair. They won't have to come here.
Right.
Where people harass them.
That's tapping into the culture.
So he brings it on campus.
Wow.
Isn't that beautiful?
Wow.
No, not many people do that. And I'm saying there are other people who could do it.
Right.
But you know what? Dion is going to do it. You watch.
Oh, yeah.
See, he went there and he saw the same thing. I'm taking my kids off the streets in Jackson, Mississippi.
Uh-huh.
I'm bringing these people here. Now, he may not be able to pay them the way Nick Saban.
Well, of course.
But the kid, those people will have the campus.
Uh-huh.
Kids on the campus will get their hair cut there.
Wow. And at the end of the day, it serves a dual role. You don't have to leave to get this done, but it also makes sure you are representing the university looking as good as you can when we travel and go someplace. One less thing for you to have to worry about.
Well, I don't know if it make them look good, the hairstyles they got today.
Different show for a different day.
Yeah, listen. I can't imagine when I was coaching that I could deal with that. But, hey, listen, times are different.
Yeah.
You got to let. But you know what he's doing? He's really taking away the kids from having to be in the wrong place at the wrong time with somebody coming approaching them.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? He's taking an element away that this could be dangerous to him.
Uh-huh.
You know, and then let's face it, these are young men. Enticements, it's easy.
It's easy.
So, yeah, I agree with that.
Wow. Way to go, Nick. That's being in touch with the young people that you're coaching. Wow.
And understand you don't want them to be in certain situations.
Yeah.
Now, you can't protect them from everything.
Of course not.
But the kids are going to be smart enough to say, man, coach really got our back.
Uh-huh.
You know, what they do, they train. They got the best eating facility. They got the best study facility. When they're not in class, they can go in there, relax, take a nap. They've got it all.
Uh-huh.
All under one roof.
Wow.
You know.
It might sound like a little thing to most people, something as simple as a haircut. But for a kid that can't afford one, a kid that doesn't have a ride off campus to get one. Little bitty things like that make a big difference. When we come back, we'll talk a little Saints. That's up next on this week's edition of the Roger Cato Show. Stay close.
Did they lay an egg for you?
Got termites? Get Premier Pest. PremierPestServices.com.
Hey, Coach Roger Cador here. There's something about teamwork that brings the best out in any business. When I need a tow, I call Roadrunner Towing. Roadrunner's four generations strong and homegrown right here in Baton Rouge.
Thanks, Coach. There's no job too large or too small. Call Roadrunner for quick, reliable, exceptional service. We don't want an arm and a leg. We just want your toes. And remember, take time each day to be a blessing to someone. Thank you.
Looking to get some keys made, locks rekeyed, or a wide variety of new and used safe? Then look no further than the trusted choice of Alfred Safe and Lock. Conveniently located off of Government Street in Mid-City Baton Rouge. Trust the expert locksmith at Alfred for all of your residential, commercial, and industrial lock and safe needs. Trusted by Baton Rouge and me, Roger Cador, to protect what is yours since 1946.
Some Baton Rouge business travelers travel out of Baton Rouge. Some don't. The ones that do know BTR is all about being closer, more convenient, with nonstops and short hops to anywhere their business takes them. They also know not flying BTR means more traffic, longer lines, and wasted time. So if it's about going from driveway to runway with a lot less highway, isn't it about time you flew BTR? Baton Rouge Metro Airport. It's about time.
Caught spiders.
Premier Pest Services.
Welcome back to this week's edition of the Roger Cator Show. Coach, let's shift gears a little bit, spending the first segment talking about bowl season. As it winds down, so does the regular season for the NFL. Saints managed to keep their playoff hopes alive, beating division rival Carolina 18-10. A win is a win is a win, is it not?
The last time I checked it was. And a loss is a loss is a loss.
Yeah,
it is, I must say. So beating Carolina, and they still got a pulse.
Uh-huh, still got a pulse. You would say it that way because I was just thinking, a very faint pulse, but a pulse. You win to keep your playoff hopes alive, but at the same time, it doesn't look good from a talent perspective. Injuries, COVID protocols, all of this. It is a win, something to be excited about, but from a talent aspect, I don't want to get too excited about it. Because at the end of the day, you're still 8-8.
Well, it's still better than 5-8.
Well, good point.
Or 5-9, whatever.
Good point. Good
you
point.
Know, you know, I just think, you know, it's with all of the injuries, you had to play with a fourth-string quarterback at one point.
Right.
I mean, that's not easy. That means you don't have continuity. You got to keep, you know.
And the fourth string didn't have the starting running back or the best receiver.
So it's just so difficult to put everything in perspective and expect.
Uh-huh.
I don't care who you have coaching. You know, when Belichick lost Brady and them guys, they didn't do very well last year.
Right.
So it doesn't matter who the coach is. It's all combined to the amount of talent you can put on the field week in and week out.
Well, we have highlights from the next-to-last regular season game for the Black and Gold. So we will roll those highlights as Coach and I continue our conversation. Once again, Coach, the defense came to play.
Yeah, the defense have done very well this year.
Seven sacks and two forced turnovers. You can't ask for anything more out of a defense.
You shouldn't. And, you know, even though they were playing the helpless Carolina Panthers.
But now, aren't you the same one that also says, one, there are no easy wins on the professional level?
I was about to say that.
Yeah.
Even though they're helpless, but they're still professionals.
Uh-huh.
You know, and they got their problems also. I read where the owner said he feel bad that he gave that guy that 7-year contract, rule the coach.
Right.
You know, and the thing is, man, when you can't put, it's just hard when you can't put the same players on the field week in and week out.
Mm-hmm.
It's just tough.
Minus 4 yards rushing for the first half for the Saints. And you still get a win. Is that one of the crazy things about the game of football and playing it at that level?
Yeah, minus 4 yards rushing. That means the defense put them in good situation, good field position, and they were able to kick field goals, obviously.
Obviously.
And so that made the difference, you know.
And, of course, being a division game, somebody that's probably more familiar with you than any other team out there, even though they're, quote, hapless, they're going to give you a struggle.
Yeah. Yeah, the guys are playing for their next paycheck. I mean, that's what they do at the professional level.
This team started out 5-2. All sorts of high hopes, all sorts of, from people like me, high expectations. You start out 5-2, end up 8-8. Is this the best example that you can find in recent memory of how quickly things can go south on the professional level?
It's not the best example. I've seen others. I mean, you know, Saints are one of many teams that it has happened to.
Right.
Where they start out good and injuries come in and then they flip over. So it does happen, you know.
Up next, the hated Dirty Birds, Atlanta Falcons. Statistically, wiped out of the playoffs. Don't have a chance to make it. But if there's anything conventional wisdom would say that will get the Falcons up for this game, it's the opportunity to knock a division rival out of the playoff race.
I would agree. And you know what? The Falcons had a chance to beat Buffalo.
Uh-huh.
They played very well.
Sure did.
Against Buffalo. So let's see what happens. You know, a divisional game, they'll be excited to play, and there'll be a lot of emotion. So we'll see what happens.
What do you tell your team from a coaching standpoint when you know the team you're facing, their sole motivation is to have you share in their misery? They can't make it to the playoffs. If nothing else, doggone it, you're not going to go either. How do you guard your team against that?
I don't know. Just play your best. Yeah, just play your best. Oh, my goodness.
Don't let
share in your misery.
Sharing. Misery loves company.
They love company.
It loves company. Sure enough. What does your gut tell you? Understanding the injury situation, COVID protocols and the like, how far can this team go in the postseason?
Not very far.
Yeah.
Guess who?
Not very far.
Cam Jordan also there.
They're not good enough to go very far. You know, good teams are going to struggle to go far in there. You know, them teams that can put up a lot of points and, you know, are the teams that and can play relatively good defense.
Right.
Are the team we got to look for to do really well in the playoffs.
So from a coaching standpoint,
guess who?
Yeah. Who else? 3.5
scratch that.
Now today for Cameron Jordan.
What do you think the team is saying amongst themselves, knowing if they're realistic? We've got a bevy of injuries. We've got COVID protocol. We've got a guy that arguably is not really a, quote, starting quarterback in the NFL. What do you think they're saying among themselves?
You want me to? I can't believe you want me to tell you.
Yeah, tell me.
I don't know. But they probably have some doubts that, but you know,
the team that the
they have limitations with what this guy can do to help them win.
Right.
And what it does, it forces guys to try and do way more than they're capable to compensate for the guy that who can't do what up to standard. You got me?
As a coach, what would you tell the team?
Guys, let's go out and have some fun and do the very best you can.
Win one for the Gipper.
Well, the Gipper was alive, but yeah, they was a TV story.
These kids nowadays had no clue who the Gipper
is. Yeah, I wouldn't tell the Gipper story. I would try to tell a story that they could relate to.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So,
does one come to mind?
Well, not right now.
Okay.
I would
have
to be in that situation.
Right.
Where my mind would be thinking that way, you know?
Right.
I didn't know you were going to ask me that question.
Realistically, looking at it for what it is, knowing the team, if they are realistic, sees it like you do. What's the motivation there?
I do know one that I thought about. J.C. Watts was an Oklahoma quarterback.
Yeah.
Played in the Orange Bowl.
Right.
And Oklahoma was winning, and he fumbled the ball and got hurt. And he was on the bench. And Switzer went and talked to him. And then the camera got on. He said, "Don't worry. I'm going to win it. And they came back and won it.
Right.
Because that was one, obviously, kids don't know who J.C. Watts is.
Nor do they know who Barry Switzer is.
That's right. But how this guy, you know, wheeled his team.
Uh-huh.
And he was hurt. So I'm sorry I cut you off, but...
No, not at all. Not at all. Good analogy. If the Saints are able to make the playoffs, win a game, what are the benefits for them going into next year?
It'll make Clarence happy. Clarence is a Saints guy.
Yeah, that'll get you a lot of brownie points. Don't mention my name with him, Coach.
Well, next year, you know, I really don't know. Teams try to win all the games that they can. Mm-hmm. Obviously, to get in the playoff in second, they really don't want to pick number one.
Right.
That means you had a bad season on number two or number three.
Right.
But if there is any consolation, you want to be able to pick where you're able to put your hand on a pretty good player.
Mm-hmm.
What the Saints need more than anything, you would have to tell me. I don't know. Their defense looked good, but you all could use another big lineman, maybe a linebacker, or a good DB. But you probably need another good running back. You probably need a speedster at the wide receiver.
Mm-hmm.
And you probably, I don't know if you need a quarterback. I mean, I don't know. I really don't know what they need, Clarence.
Well, the good news is, they get paid to figure that out. When we come back, we're going to talk about something that has the entire football universe talking. What is arguably, in our lifetimes, the craziest thing we've ever seen from an individual on any level, much less the professional level. I was trying to think last night if I've ever seen anything in person remotely close to what Antonio Brown did this past weekend. We'll get this break out of the way, and we'll come back and talk about the story that just has folks scratching their heads when we continue this week's edition of the Roger Cador Show. Stay close.
Getting a letter from the IRS that you owe back taxes can be scary, but it doesn't have to be. Call Go Tax Resolution in Lafayette at 337-420-1040 today. We'll help stop garnishments, levies, and seizures immediately. With over 35 years of dealing directly with the IRS, our team of local professionals will help you pay the least amount possible. So if you owe back taxes to the IRS, you need help. Call the tax professionals at Go Tax Resolution in Lafayette at 337-420-1040. Your go-to tax relief.
Hi,
am Hurricane Betsy Barnes.
And I'm Dr. Kay Siller with the Rocket Right Show.
We are two busy blondes on the go showing off life in Louisiana.
Watch us on Pelican Sports Network.
And Talk 107.3 FM. Check local listings for times.
Hello, guys. It's Debbie. It's time. I've got a brand new location. 10510 Airline Highway, Baton Rouge, next to After Five Tuxedos. We have the perfect spot to get all your wedding and formal wear needs. Come see our one-of-a-kind name brand and get great prices. With 30 years experience, the best customer service anywhere. It's Debbie's Bridal, Airline Highway, Baton Rouge. See you soon.
Smart Baton Rouge business travelers travel out of Baton Rouge because BTR is so close and convenient, they're always one step ahead rather than dead on their feet. So, isn't it about time you flew BTR? Baton Rouge Metro Airport.
Have a passion? We've got the place. Gear up for where the rubber meets the mud or stir up memories of a lifetime. Reach new heights. Gravitate towards something out of this world. Even travel back in time. You might like a little drama in your life, or get in touch with your inner nature lover. Release some pent-up energy while you're at it. There's plenty to do beyond the swing sets. BRAC, we're more than a playground.
Welcome back for this week's edition of the Roger Cador Show. You guys and girls know I am a big fan of old adages. The older Americans among us did a heck of a job in encapsulating certain things that happen in life and relating that to us in everyday terms. One of the things that I very fondly remember older Americans saying, if you live long enough, you see just about everything. If God blesses you to just keep on breathing, you're going to see just about everything that life has to offer. Well, I'm going to be the first to admit what is arguably, at least was arguably, en route to being the greatest wide receiver in the history of the National Football League, suffered a complete and total meltdown on national television. Antonio Brown stripping down, throwing his gear off, throwing t-shirt and gloves into the crowd and giving them the peace out as he ran off the field. Have you ever seen anything like that before, Coach?
Have you? I haven't.
The only thing I can remember anywhere close to that, hosting Eddie Robinson's TV show, it was a game, don't take it as gospel, I want to say it was Valley or Prairie View, playing in Grambling. And Grambling was beating them up pretty bad. They punt the ball, kick returner for Grambling, sees a hole, shoots on the sideline. He's going to score a game.
And somebody tackled him.
Somebody came off the bench and leveled him. That's the only thing I've ever experienced in person, remotely close. Have you ever seen anything like what Antonio Brown did?
No, but I did see something. I saw two other things. Uh-huh. I saw someone streak at a baseball game.
Oh, those, that, well, yeah.
I mean, that's crazy.
Yeah.
And then there was a guy when I was growing up. It wasn't in front of a bunch of people.
Uh-huh.
He was over a motor vehicle or something. Had a really good job. And he must have flipped.
Right.
And he came to the store in just his underwear. And everybody, you're talking about in the 60s.
Wow.
And everybody was so shocked. They were afraid to say it. And everybody were watching him. I never forget that. So you say, you, and this guy hadn't been hit. Like Antonio,
right.
Guy, what did the guy? His poor wife was trying to get him in, back into the house. He had a drink in his hand, and you know.
Yeah,
but
let me get one of them Snickers bars. Yeah. Back there. Oh wait, doggone it! I forgot my wallet.
But no, Antonio,
you forgot your pants.
Oh, my goodness. That was crazy. The 60, probably 1962 or 63 when that happened. But Antonio Brown, let's get back to him. I try to look at it. I was trying to look at his face expression.
Right.
Because that the face says a lot.
Oh, yeah.
About what's going on.
What's
and that
going
was,
on inside.
It was no emotion on the face. It showed no anger. It was no anger.
Right.
That's what got me. If he was angry with the coach, why didn't it show on his face?
Uh-huh. What was the, before you analyzed all of it, when you saw it, what was the first thing that popped into your head?
Nothing popped. I was just
in shock.
Yes. I mean, I was in shock. I was just in shock. I mean, you know, being a coach and in the heat of battle, which the coach must have been, they were concentrating on the game.
Right.
You know, things like that happen. I've had guys do crazy stuff, and I tell the coaches, handle it, assistant coach. Go handle that. You got me?
Is that part of the reason why the NFL goes through such an exhaustive process? And they've come under fire for this. Before they sign you, they will sit down and ask you all sorts of questions to try to probe what's in your mind, what's in the back of your mind, what kind of teammates you're going to make, what we can expect from you. They do it every year. In doing some research, I found out his first year in college, he was expelled from school after getting into a physical altercation with a fellow student. Scholarship was voided. He ended up walking on with the Chippewas after that, and the rest is history.
He was at Western Michigan or Eastern Michigan?
Eastern Michigan, I think.
I know he was in Michigan.
But before he got to play it down, he was expelled from the school. And you know, it's well documented, the problems in Pittsburgh. I think he lasted, 1 week with New England. Had major problems with the Raiders, and now this. But I gotta wonder, going to bat for this guy, knowing his background, Tom Brady was the lead cheerleader for this guy.
Yeah.
When he moved to Tampa, he told him, look, don't worry about finding a place to live right now. Come to my house. Live with me and my family. So I know Brady's got to feel particularly blindsided by all of this. What does your gut tell you? Will he ever play pro football again?
I don't think Tom Brady would blindside it. I think he is the one person through his conversation who understands Antonio has a problem.
Mm-hmm.
So when you know people got problems, you're not blindsided. It's not their fault. When people have issues, it's not always their fault.
Yeah.
The demons has control over their emotions. You got me?
Right.
And Brady understands that. That's why he said, let's not give up. Forget about him. Let's try to do something to try and help him. Because he said he is loved by his teammates.
Mm-hmm.
See, to me, I keep saying, everybody said that he's a good teammate. They love him.
Right.
So it tells me he's got an issue. That's not controllable by him.
Now, while the teammates have said that about his past, when a guy doesn't last but 1 week with Belichick,
but hold up. The reason he only lasts 1 week, it was something he had previously did that came to light and they got rid of him.
Right.
Because it came to light. But he didn't do anything with New England.
Who was the team, and you all forgive me for not making a notation on that, where he called the GM and the owner saltine, and you know what comes after, saltine.
No. Cracker.
Oh. There you go.
I'm sorry.
There you
well,
go.
Saltine cracker.
Not as sorry as Antonio Brown is.
Well, I don't know who he did that with. I don't even remember.
And my point is, the guy has a history. If you go back through and...
You can go all you want and try to... If he's got mental issues, mm-hmm. it's not his fault. It's because...
Did the league then enable him? I mean, they
yeah,
knew...
Yeah, well, the league could do something, but the league doesn't want to do that because they don't want to deny anyone an opportunity. The league is saying to individual teams, you make that decision
right.
who you bring and put on your roster.
Uh-huh.
You got me?
Does the NFL, the league, do they need to make a statement with the punishment for this, or should the individual franchise handle
it? Who did Antonio Brown hurt other than himself?
Well, the Bucks and their chances for Super Bowl.
Yeah.
And I would go so far as to say the image of the league itself.
Well, the image is definitely tarnished, but you know what? I looked at it, and the people were having a good time of it. Now, the image he heard uh-huh. was the people who were at home with their family, the true family people, your members. You got me?
Right.
Parents with their kids.
Right.
Obviously, they don't want their kids to see that. You got me?
Mm-hmm.
But that doing average fan loved it. You didn't see them? They were cheering him on.
If you're the commissioner of the NFL, how do you handle this?
The team got to handle it first. The team. This is why I'm sure Goodell hasn't gotten involved, mm-hmm. is that he wants the team right. to handle it.
Right.
Because other than the image of the league, he hadn't broken any rule.
True. True.
You got me? So that's why I'm saying it's sort of thin ice here, what we're dealing with. Now, we know a guy got some issues. That's what we really got to try and deal with first.
Mm-hmm.
Let's try to get this man some help, you know.
If you could sit down one-on-one, no cameras, no teammates, no NFL officials, no family, just you and Antonio Brown, what would you tell him?
I'll stick a camera under the wake. I'm only joking. I would never do that.
Let me record this just in case.
Yeah.
What are you telling?
You're a wonderful person. You know, you're killing your image. Mm-hmm. We think you need some help. Let's at least do a diagnostic test.
Mm-hmm.
Diagnose what could be going on here.
Right.
Do it for your family. Your family is suffering from watching uh-huh. you do this. Let's try to do it. And if we could get you the correct medication, you could extend your career. That's what I would be trying to tell him.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's help.
Yeah.
If Marty could get help, he can.
Will he ever play in the NFL again?
I don't know.
Let me rephrase that. What does he have to do?
I just said it. Go get some help.
Uh-huh.
I think if he goes and shows that he's trying to get help.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, there's a young man that's 33, might have been 35, that just died. Jackson might have been was a wide receiver. Played with San Diego, played with Tampa, just took his life maybe 4 or 5 months ago.
Sure did, yeah.
35 years old.
Mm-hmm.
You got me? And he exhibited some bizarre behavior
right.
before that happened. You got
uh-huh.
me?
Uh-huh.
So my thing is, let's not fool ourselves. He's taking some hits. And maybe he's able to go a few months and without being, and then it comes out.
Right.
I mean, we got to watch it. We just really need to watch this thing, you know.
It is bizarre. It is.
And it's dangerous that we got him out on the street.
True.
You know, so I don't take this lightly. I'd say help, help, help. Help, help, help. Let's help him. And the guy calls himself a gremlin. You know that's not natural.
Yeah. Of course, now, at the end of the day, you can only help people that are willing to accept help. And good or bad, right or wrong, you could make the argument he's been needing help for a little while now.
I would say so.
Yeah.
I said that I do agree with you 100% there. You know,
it's just sad that no one recognized it. And maybe I shouldn't say that, because maybe they did and attempted to get him help, and he told them, "Man, get out of here. I don't need that. I'm fine." But at the end of the day, it's tragic. It's sad to see an individual that was Hall of Fame, maybe the greatest of all time receiver material, to put himself in a situation that most people just cannot figure out. We'll take our final break of today's show, come back and wrap up week 18 of the Roger Cador Show. Stay close.
Got termites? Get Premier Pest. PremierPestServices.com.
Looking to get some keys made, locks rekeyed, or a wide variety of new and used safe? Then look no further than the trusted choice of Alfred Safe and Lock. Conveniently located off of Government Street in Mid-City Baton Rouge, trust the expert locksmith at Alfred for all of your residential, commercial, and industrial lock and safe needs. Trusted by Baton Rouge and me, Roger Cador, to protect what is yours since 1946.
Hey, Coach Roger Cador here. There's something about teamwork that brings the best out in any business. When I need a tow, I call Roadrunner Towing. Roadrunner's four generations strong and homegrown right here in Baton Rouge.
Thanks, Coach. There's no job too large or too small. Call Roadrunner for quick, reliable, exceptional service. We don't want an arm and a leg. We just want your toes. And remember, take time each day to be a blessing to someone. Thank you.
Caught spiders. Premier Pest Services.
Welcome back to the final segment of Marty. Today's edition of the Roger Cador Show. Coach, it is one of the idiosyncrasies of life is that if God blesses you to stick around long enough, you witness as a natural part of human evolution the deaths of people you idolized for many, many years. And in recent memory, it seems as though, as I guess it should be, the list is getting longer and longer, but it seems to be accelerating. The sports world, particularly HBCUs and many others in recent memory, saying a fond farewell to some individuals that were legendary. At the age of 85, former Mideastern Athletic Conference, also known as the MEAC, Commissioner Ken Free passing on. What do you remember about Ken?
Well, you know, that he did a wonderful job as a leader, gave a lot of people opportunity, and he had the MEAC at his finest hours with all of the things that were future things that he was doing to make the MEAC competitive.
Also, passing away last week, listed as one of the 73 greatest all-time NBA players, Sam Jones, dying at the age of 88. Legend in his profession.
Lived a long life.
Amen.
I'm trying to get there.
Amen. And many people may not equate this guy with HBCUs because he was more on the professional level than the collegiate level. But John Madden, and I didn't know this until I started doing a little digging and some research, dying at the age of 85, drafted HBCU players Eldridge Dickey, quarterback from Tennessee State, Art Shell, offensive lineman, Maryland Eastern Shore, Raymond Chester, tight end, Morgan State, Henry Lawrence, FAMU, Charles Filion, Texas Southern, and you reminded me, Warren Wells from Texas Southern. HBCUs owe a bit of a debt of gratitude to John Madden, don't we?
They really do. He and Hank Stram, they were really, really visionaries. They saw that where the pool of talent was, were at the African-American schools, and they went in there and got them.
Yeah.
And I got to give the Hunt guy that started the league, you got to give him some credit, too, for saying, let's go get him.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And so it's it really was a thing that American Football League has so many great athletes.
Most people, and maybe it's just a part of the human experience, why is it, do you think, many people don't recognize greatness until it's passed?
I don't know. I really wish I knew the answer to that, Clarence. But that's a good... And to people, you know, I've said it over and over. People also will wait. They won't come and see you when you're alive, but they'll come to when you're dead. Doesn't make sense.
Yeah, good point.
Doesn't add up.
Good point.
Why go when someone is dead when they don't know you're there?
Yeah. Well, on another note, we are very happy for a dear friend of the show and a guy that is one of my favorite people on the planet overall. This week, LSU not going to wait until the guy's dead. They're going to formally name the court in the Maravich Assembly Center after legendary coach Dale Brown.
Well, that's wonderful. He deserved it. I mean, he did a lot to make LSU known in basketball, but he brought integration to LSU.
Oh, yeah.
He forced the issue through difficult times, and he stood there.
Yep.
And he deserved that coach being named after him.
And for you young people that may not know, Dale Brown was asked once in an interview, years after he retired, what's the biggest difference between when you arrived at LSU and when you left LSU? And I think you know what he said. When I came to LSU, they had one black player. When I left, there was only one white one left.
Yeah.
he sat through an era. And let's be honest about this. There was a faction, and I will leave to y'all to decide how big this group of people happened at the time to be. But they didn't take kindly to Dale Brown bringing all these black kids into the Maravich Assembly Center to represent the state's flagship university.
Well, they didn't understand. They didn't know. You know, ignorance had blinded them with racism.
Yeah.
And they couldn't understand. Mm-hmm. And fortunate for Louisiana and the world, as these older people die, so do some of their ways of thinking.
Misguided ways of thinking, yeah.
New generation not going to think that way.
Uh-huh.
And it's so much better for the state and the world to be that way.
You talk about how things get passed from generation to generation and how young people don't think the way those folk were thinking back then. Does it pain you the way it does me that if children were simply left alone, not saddled with our attitudes, with our opinions, our prejudices, our biases, if we just left them alone, how much better the world would be?
Well, I don't know how much better the world would be, because I do go to that God gave kids parents for a reason.
Right.
So the parents can raise them and teach them all of the good things that the world have to offer.
Supposedly. Right.
So I really don't see how kids could be benefited if we don't give them the roadmap. And that's what parents are supposed to do. Provide a roadmap for the kids to be able to do better than they did.
And you can make the argument that the most important exit ramp on the road of life for children is teaching them and instilling discipline.
Oh, I agree. That's why the Bible said don't spare the rod to a kid so you can disciplinary them.
We talked about this with Jonathan, but I definitely wanted to give you the opportunity to talk about it. Southern University recently graduating 34 athletes, conferring college degrees, some of whom were the very first in their family to get a college education. 10 football players, 9 baseball players, 4 in track and field, 2 each, men's and women's basketball, 1 for volleyball, 1 tennis, 1 softball, and lest we forget, 3 cheerleaders. At the end of the day, all the hoorah in the world, this is what the mission is truly supposed to be, is it not?
Yeah, to graduate kids. And before we run out of time, I want to mention that on Friday in Chicago, I'll be going into the ABCA Hall of Fame. I know we've talked about a lot of things. I didn't want to pass and not let our people out there know.
Right.
Why didn't Roger tell us that?
Yeah.
We could have been praying for him and sending him
somewhere. No, don't pray, though.
Now, let folks know who the ABCA is.
American Baseball Coaches Association.
Has it sunk in just yet that here this guy is from the island side of New Roads? Father was a sharecropper, early years of schooling in a segregated environment, went to a school, first coaching job, could put everything the program owned in a shopping cart. And now he's going to be inducted into the American Baseball Coaches Association Hall of Fame. Has it sunk in yet?
Well, sort of, because you know what? I was on the mission not to be a Hall of Famer, but to help people.
Yep.
And to do my very best. And I remember my wife used to tell me all the time, make sure you do the very best for the kids. Mm-hmm. Take care of the kids. So I took care of them and they took care of me by winning a lot of games, and that's how I got in.
What is most impressive to me, Coach, this award, not that there's anything wrong with it, don't y'all get upset. This isn't coming from a black coaching association. It's American Baseball Coaches.
Yeah. Yeah, it's
what does that say to you?
Well, somebody, when they did the voting, coaches, the committee who did the voting is a collection of people from all over the country. Mm-hmm. And when the names came up, my name was in that pool, and my name came up. They only did 8 people every year.
Right.
It's about 8. So it tells you how difficult it is to get in. There's over 3,000 schools.
He's a little modest, so I'll say it. It says that America is the place where anybody, if they're willing to make the sacrifice, can reach the highest levels. That's going to do it for today's show. On behalf of, I think it's Jonathan and Alan in the truck, Marty on the floor, the coach, I'm Clarence Bugs. We'll see you next week with another edition of the Roger Cador Show. Go Jags.